everybody. I'm Patricia Duff with The Common Good, and I am very excited to have this expert panel today to discuss the latest on COVID-19 and the pandemic. As of today, there are over 1 million deaths worldwide and already 220,000 deaths here in the United States. Strikingly, tragically, the U.S. is number one in the world in the number of individuals infected and, more horrifying, in the number of deaths. And this fall and winter will likely bring even greater numbers to the death toll and more disruption to our economy. Nevertheless, over the past several months, we have learned a lot about the virus. We know more about how to avoid getting it, how to treat it, and we are hopefully moving closer to developing a vaccine against it. My significant other and I actually caught the virus early in mid-March, and although we had a mild version, we were pretty darn sick, and I would not wish this illness on anybody. There are too many potential short-term and long-term effects, let alone the possibility of death. But do people like us still have immunity these several months later? Does the fact that we have type O blood make any difference in our cases being mild? According to our tests, we were shedding virus at least 3 weeks after having symptoms. How long does it take before you are no longer a threat to others? I think about all of this as we see more and more public figures, including our president, contract the virus and fatality figures mount. Is the administration relying on herd immunity as a way to resolve this pandemic? Is that wise or even possible? How effective will the Regeneron treatment be for others, as effective as it seems to have been for the president? So much new information is available and so much to discuss, so let's get right to the panel. I am joined by three brilliant medical experts who can give us the latest information you should know. First, meet Dr. Daniel Lucey. He is an important expert in infectious diseases based at Georgetown University, my alma mater, thank you. Dr. Lucey has traveled the world with each epidemic on the ground, studying, fighting, and treating diseases from SARS and Ebola to yellow fever, Zika, and even the plague. Dr. Lucey has been dedicated to fighting illnesses and was one of the first doctors to treat people with HIV/AIDS in San Francisco as the AIDS outbreak was just beginning. More recently, Dr. Lucey traveled to Asia from February to March to study the COVID-19 disease. Dr. Lucey, your work is so important and we welcome you. I'm thrilled to introduce another major leader in the medical field, former CDC Director Tom Frieden, whom you may see frequently on TV news channels. As director of the CDC under the Obama administration, Dr. Frieden worked tirelessly to end the Ebola pandemic. He also launched the initiative to prevent 500,000 heart attacks and strokes and is credited with sounding the alarm to address the epidemic of opioid use. As New York City Health Commissioner, he led the charge against the largest outbreak of multi-drug-resistant tuberculosis ever to occur in the U.S., resulting in the creation of the current program to fight this dreaded version of TB that is a model for the entire country and the world. Director Frieden, it is a pleasure and an honor to have you with us. And I am proud and honored to introduce a leader and a dear friend who has served her country in so many ways, Rear Admiral Susan Blumenthal. Susan has provided distinguished service for more than two decades as a leading national U.S. government health expert and spokesperson in the administrations of four U.S. presidents. She was the country's first Deputy Assistant Secretary for Women's Health, served as Senior Global Health Advisor for HHS, as White House Health Advisor, as the Chief of Behavioral Medicine and Basic Prevention Research at the National Institutes of Health, and as U.S. Assistant Surgeon General, just to name a few of her posts. Notably, she's been involved in the national response to the anthrax threat and the H1N1 pandemic. Additionally, Susan Blumenthal is a dedicated advocate and leader in women's health. I think that's how I first met you, Susan. Responsible for exposing the inequities in women's health and emphatically pushing this topic into the limelight. Susan, thank you and welcome. We are thrilled you're serving as our moderator today. So welcome to all of our experts, three iconic leaders in the medical and scientific community. And now I turn the conversation over to you, Susan.
Thanks so much, Patricia, for your important leadership and for bringing us all together today. As you mentioned, in America, over 220,000 people have died. That's on average 900 a day. It would be the equivalent of four 767 jet plane crashes every 24 hours. In the world, as you underscored, 1 million people have perished. These casualties are not the result of another country attacking us. We are at war with an invisible enemy, COVID-19. 50,000 new infections every day in America. 8 million people have had the disease in our country over the past 9 months, and 40 million globally. America is lagging behind in defeating this enemy. While the US represents 5% of the world's population, we have 20% of all the deaths from this disease. A New England Journal editorial recently called the US response to the pandemic an astonishing failure, with the administration turning this crisis into a tragedy. I think that the COVID pandemic is the Pearl Harbor of public health, as our nation was woefully unprepared for this assault on the well-being of Americans and our country's economy. In fact, a recent report estimates that the economic loss to our nation will be more than twice the total expenditures for all the wars America has fought since 9/11, including Afghanistan, Iraq, and Syria. We would never dream of sending our soldiers into combat without state-of-the-art helmets, armor, and weapons, yet our country's health professionals were lacking adequate personal protection equipment when the virus struck. Years of neglect and underfunding of America's public health infrastructure had left our nation extremely vulnerable to an infectious disease threat, despite the fact that 40 new diseases have emerged since 1968 alone, including AIDS, Zika, Lyme's disease, and West Nile encephalitis. Public health experts have warned for years that a pandemic was coming, urging policymakers and the public to heed what Hippocrates taught us thousands of years ago: prevention is preferable to cure. The pandemic has also exposed shameful health disparities for people of color and frontline communities, with 2 to 3 times higher death rates among these populations from COVID-19. Men have higher death rates from the disease than do women. We need to learn more about these sex, racial, and ethnic differences. Problems in data collection, testing, contact tracing, and an infodemic of misinformation about the virus have undermined an effective response. And alarmingly, as a result, mistrust in government has grown. This is very shameful and very disturbing. I think that, again, we are now facing this disease. We're seeing that that the rates have risen in 45 states recently. In fact, some of them are reporting some of the highest levels, alarming public health experts, specifically with the twindemics of COVID-19 and pandemic flu and flu converging this fall. Despite a revolution in scientific and technological advances, we have, again, we're fighting this disease with the weapons of proven public health practices that we did for the Spanish flu in 1918. We should be farther along. Thankfully, because of scientific and technological advances, we're now seeing important developments in vaccine development, medications, therapeutics, but we should be farther along. So, that sort of sets the stage. I think that with billions of dollars of new funding, we're now seeing vaccines and treatments being developed, we've seen a total strike on the nation and global economy. And we need to do everything we can together across all sectors of society to address these issues. Well, this afternoon, my two distinguished colleagues, Dr. Tom Frieden and Dr. Daniel Lucey, are going to discuss with you the past, the present, and future of COVID-19. How did we get here? How did this happen? Where we currently stand, what the future holds, and the roadmap needed to beat the virus in the months and years ahead. Well, first, let's start at the beginning. Dr. Lucey, you've spent your career investigating outbreaks of zoonotic diseases, where a disease jumps from an animal to a human, like Ebola, Zika, and COVID-19. President Trump calls this pandemic the China virus. And some have even speculated it originated or was engineered in a Wuhan laboratory and perhaps even deliberately released. What do you think is the most credible theory of how COVID-19 emerged? And how do disease detectives like yourself go about identifying a novel virus and mapping its spread?
Well, thank you very much, Susan, for the question. And thank you to Patricia Duff for the invitation to be with everyone here today. And it's a honor to join with Tom for this conversation before the audience Q&A. So since I first read a media report on the evening December the 30th here in Washington, D.C. about Dr. Wenjing Li, the ophthalmologist in his mid-30s, who was sending messages to medical colleagues saying there was concern about a SARS-like disease, contagious disease in Wuhan. I've been following the story, if you will, making the trip February 11th to the mainland, to Shanghai, which is as close as I could get, unfortunately, to Wuhan. So I've tried to follow all of the possible ways that the virus might have originated. And I think of them three ways, EIN, intentional, accidental, or natural. And in my view, at this point, what we know is not everything that we need to know. And there is a WHO China team going to investigate the origins, hopefully very soon, within the coming couple of weeks. But in my view, the most likely explanation, this was naturally occurring, probably in China, probably Hubei province, where Wuhan is the capital, but not necessarily. Wuhan is the high-speed train hub for all of China. And one of the three major train stations in Wuhan is very, very close, less than a kilometer, to the seafood market that was initially and erroneously said to be the origin of this epidemic. I call it the red herring market, if you will. And the head of the CDC for China in Beijing, Dr. George Fu Gao, or Gao Fu, someone who I know, have met in person, respect a great deal for his work in Sierra Leone during Ebola. He said officially in Beijing, May 23rd, it was in the press, that that seafood market was not the source of the virus. It was just another victim. Obviously, he's also said that the labs were not the source of the virus. So I contacted him. He confirmed that he was accurately quoted. But when I asked, well, then what was the source, or where was the source? He said, well, we have some other options, but he didn't go into any specific details. So I think it's naturally occurring. I think that it began months before December when it was first recognized. And the reason I say that is because the first we heard about it in December, it was already fully adapted to our species, to humans, in terms of being efficiently spread from person to person, primarily through the air, but in other ways as well. So I would say back to September, maybe even the summer or earlier in Hubei province is when it began, probably through, not directly from a bat, but through an intermediate animal, which has yet to be identified despite approximately 290 days.
It's been reported
that's my long answer. Thank you.
Well, it's been reported that there have been different strains that came from China and or Asia and Europe into the United States. Now several people seem to have been reinfected. What's the difference between these strains? Has the virus mutated? Could genetic epidemiology help? I mean, the US has genetically sequenced just 0.4% of the nearly 8 million coronavirus cases in our country, a proportion that's been surpassed by 40 other countries. As scientific leaders in the world, why are we so far behind? Dr. Lucey.
All the easy questions, thank you. there are genetically distinguishable SARS coronavirus 2 viruses, the virus that causes COVID-19 disease. There was a report just in the past few days, past week, from Nevada of a person that was reported to have been infected twice, 48 days apart here in the United States. It was the same we call a clade or sort of family of SARS coronavirus 1, clade 20C. But there were sufficient genetic variation between the two viruses that had been isolated from this patient, a young man, I think 25 years old in Nevada, that it was clear that he'd been reinfected. So there is a great need, and I think underscored by this report, but more generally, sort of a genetic epidemiology or genetic sleuthing, if you will, plays a very important role, did certainly during Ebola, it has in HIV and many other diseases. So I think that, as you point out, Susan, there's more that I believe that our country should and can and will, I think, in the near future do in terms of genetic sequencing and the public health ramifications or benefit that come from that.
Great, well, thank you. Dr. Frieden, would you provide us with a progress report on where we stand in the battle today against COVID-19?
Well, within the U.S., unfortunately, the U.S. continues to fail. We have cases increasing in most of the country. We have basically not deployed the tools we have that can make a difference. We seem to both keep searching for the one thing that will make a difference, when in fact, there is no one thing that's going to make a huge difference. And second, we haven't really accepted that we need a comprehensive approach that will result in reducing the level of spread and also then stopping spread where it occurs. So what we see is a response that lacks three essential components. The first is that we are not organized for battle. There is no clear organizational management of the response. The second is we're not on the same page. We're not looking at the data and saying, here's where we are with the response. Here's where we are with what we need to do to stop it. And third, the communication has been terribly bungled by a White House that has been politicizing and confusing issues as simple as, I see that we've got a problem with the camera. I'll come back on in a minute and I'll keep talking for a moment. We have an administration that has been politicizing even simple things, and also the reality that what should be straightforward, simple interventions have become increasingly political and controversial. And so we're not only not organized for battle, we're not only not winning the battle, but we're increasingly behind the virus. And really, if you look at the map of the U.S., only the Maine and Vermont in the most recent data show even somewhat encouraging trends. And most of the rest of the country is showing either high rates or increasing rates. So we have just a tremendous challenge with the response nationally, which is really a reflection of a federal failure.
Right. Well, you mentioned that we're politicizing some of the tools that we have. Dr. Lucey, I think one of those tools that's been politicized are masks. It's been reported that if 95% of Americans wore masks, we could save 100,000 lives by January 1st. You have a deep interest in anthropology. Why, given common sense public health recommendations, do people not put them into practice? What needs to be done to make our public health messaging more effective, such as the importance of wearing masks?
The most important overarching principle is earning the trust of the great majority of the American population so that they understand why they should wear a mask, both for themselves and for their loved ones, but also people that they don't love, people they don't know. And that's the most difficult thing to do, I would argue, which I wouldn't have predicted. I never did in all these years and decades of responding to epidemics and working with the U.S. Health and Human Services and NIH and other folks here. It's earning trust in order to improve behavior that helps slow down and eventually stop the epidemic.
I think too, what you're saying about trust is, I know when I served in the government for two decades, I mean, when these crises hit, we relied on having one trusted official that would be a kind of coherent and continuous source of information, often a physician, to communicate. And I think there's just been so many voices and so much confusion and so misinformation as a result. Dr. Frieden, there's been much criticism of the CDC over the past month. It used to be the jewel of public health. And as a former CDC director, in your opinion, what's gone wrong with the government's response and what's gone right? What could have been done better? You've mentioned some of the actions that should have been undertaken. How can we make our government more pandemic prepared in the future? Do you think there, for example, should be a White House coordinating office in the National Security Council?
Well, there are a lot of questions there. Let me take them kind of one at a time. First, in terms of CDC, they've certainly made mistakes, particularly with the rollout of the laboratory test. But fundamentally, they've been sidelined, undermined, and criticized. And the political meddling into science at CDC is unprecedented. I don't think there has ever been a time when people in Washington with no public health experience wrote things and directed that they be put on CDC website as if it were public health advice. So this is a really an unprecedented political interference with a public health agency. They've also been silenced. Mm-hmm. If you look back at what Dr. Nancy Messonnier was saying in January and February and Dr. Schuchat saying in the months after, they were leveling with the American people. They were saying what was happening. They were getting Americans to prepare and they were shut down. So I think to blame the CDC for this is kind of like blaming someone who's been bound and encased in cement for failing to swim. They haven't been allowed to do their job. This hasn't been a failure of public health. It's been a failure to support and be guided by public health. And if we look around the world, the countries and the places that have been guided by public health have done a lot better. Not only have they had fewer cases and less death, they've had less economic dislocation as well. Now, in terms of how this should run and should there be a White House coordinator, I can say that during Ebola, when Ron Klain was named the White House Ebola coordinator, that worked really well because it meant that all of the government was working in a concerted way. And that's important because it's a big government. There are a lot of things that need to be done consistently. What's interesting is he never overruled any technical decision of the CDC or, as far as I know, any other agency. It was more, let's get on the same page, get it done, agree on what we're going to do, and then track our progress in doing it. We need to invest a lot in public health in this country and globally, because we've had decades of underinvestment in the US. We have weak informatics, we have weak human resources, but also globally, we know that unless we engage more with the world, we're not going to be able to find and stop problems at the source, and we're going to end up having to spend more money to fight them here in this country. So I think this has to be a wake-up call for supporting public health, both within the US and globally.
Well, I certainly would agree with that. I think people need to understand that America's health is global health, and global health is America's health. In an interdependent, interconnected world, the spread of a disease is just a jet plane away. You know, I served in the government for other issues where they were politicized, for example, gun prevention control. I remember in a Republican administration, you know, having the CDC take gun violence research issues off the website. And it's only been 25 years later that they've now finally been funded to do gun violence prevention research. So it's happened before, but this is at an unprecedented level. I would agree with you. I do think our agencies need to be more modernized. I think that there needs to be more, as you said, informatics, data collection, doing new ways, real time. The states and local government needs to be better coordinated with the federal systems. And so I agree, politicization, but also modernization of our agencies. Dr. Lucey, from your perspective, what's gone wrong and what's gone right in our nation's response? And as we've been talking about, as Dr. Frieden touched upon, are there lessons to be learned from other countries to better inform our own? You know, what nations have had the best practices? What do they include? And do you think, and how has the virus changed the world? Has it unified the medical and scientific community or fostered competition across countries, for example, in vaccine development?
My Susan, that's a lot of questions. And I'm sure Tom would like to comment as well, and it really builds, he started to answer some of these, and so I'd like to build on what he said and then add a few thoughts, but keeping it brief. Starting with the final questions, the virus has done both things in terms of bringing countries and people within countries together, but also separating countries to some extent. And I think that's unfortunately sort of emblematic of the US and China in terms of separation. And the US pulling out of the World Health Organization, which fortunately it's a 12-month process. So it was started this July, it won't be finalized till next July, but some things have already begun, which I strongly am against the United States pulling out of World Health Organization, even though I think the World Health Organization did do some things that were suboptimal and frankly wrong in January with regard to the initial outbreak and when they declared a public health emergency of international concern. I think it should have been sooner in January 22nd, 23rd. Also, the United States is not part of the so-called COVAX, the WHO's 171 nations, now including China, to develop vaccines against COVID for all countries in the world, the low income, middle income, as well as the higher income. So those are things that have not gone right, but still can, still could, and hopefully will. Tom pointed out some of the issues in the States as far as not having a accurate diagnostic test for approximately 5 weeks until the end of February. It was our decision, the United States decision, not to use the rapid diagnostic or the PCR diagnostic test that the World Health Organization made available that was developed in Germany and turned out to be quite accurate. So that was a big problem. But in addition, there have been other major problems in terms of national leadership, in terms of not recognizing the gravity and the scope of the pandemic in our country. And for me, getting back just briefly to the very first part of the first question you asked me, Susan, how do we recognize epidemics amidst all of the background epidemics and outbreaks that are going on all the time in our world? How do you recognize the ones that are likely to become regional or even worldwide? And I think that the most important concept, in my view, is recognition. It's exactly what is needed. And in this case, for me, the recognition was on the night of December 30th when there were healthcare workers, it turned out there were eight, who were sending messages to colleagues saying that there's a SARS-like contagious virus going on. Mm-hmm. That's a huge red flag. for me, yellow fever in Congo was the shortage of vaccine in 2016. And Zika in Brazil, I went to the Congo, then I went to Brazil, was because of the children with the small head size, which really wasn't about the small head size, it was what was the reason, and that was underdevelopment or absence of entire parts of the human brain. So recognition to me is an essential, missing, important, crucial part of what usually the United States, the CDC, the U.S. Agency for International Development, the NIH, and the World Health Organization always talk about: prevent, detect, and respond. And I agree with all those things, but there needs to be a fourth one, and that's recognition. So that we know something is going to be big, and then recognize what we need to do so that we don't do things wrong and we do things right in a comprehensive, rapid, and sustained manner to stop the epidemic.
Right. And I think, as Louis Pasteur once says, chance favors the prepared mind, that we need to be prepared. There needs to be leadership and communication amongst, across town and across countries. Dr. Frieden, testing has been a big issue in our country and around the world. Can you discuss what types of diagnostic tests are available for COVID? Are they accurate? And who should be tested and how often?
So I think there's been some misunderstanding both of tests and of the role of testing. So if we start with just talking about the tests themselves, there are many different platforms for PCR or nucleic acid tests. Those range from the 15-minute Abbott test to the 4-hour Cepheid test to 24 to 48-hour tests in many academic laboratories to some commercial laboratories and others. The PCR tests are quite accurate. It's rare to have a false positive, You can get false negatives because maybe the sample wasn't collected well, but that's as close as we have to a gold standard. More recently, there have been antigen tests. Antigen tests have the benefit of being lower cost and quick, but they're not very accurate. So this relates to something called Bayes' law, which is basically the accuracy of a test is not inherent in that test. It depends on the population being tested. So if you take a test that's 99% accurate or in a high prevalence population and you test a low prevalence population, you may end up with 80% of your positives being false positive. So understanding not just the performance of the test, but their role within different populations is very important. Antibody tests are another very confusing area. And I feel here that the US FDA kind of has failed to reach the Goldilocks point. When it came to PCR tests, they were far too stringent. And well into end of February, early March, they were prohibiting labs from developing their own tests. This was a colossal blunder on the part of the administration. Then when serological tests came, they made the opposite mistake. And like, whatever you want, put it on the market. And so we had garbage tests out there. To start with, we don't know what a positive test would mean, but making that even more problematic, the tests that were there were very inaccurate. So the antibody tests are a great confusion right now and have very limited roles. We don't know what being antibody positive means. We don't know for how long you'll be protected. We don't know which antibodies are protective. We don't know how long the antibodies last. There are rare conditions where it may have some utility. For example, a kid with Kawasaki-like illness who's PCR negative may help you understand that, yes, they had COVID in the past. But more important than all of that is to understand the role of testing within control. And the crux, one of the biggest errors that led to the White House cluster was an over-reliance on testing. Testing in and of itself is of very little use. Testing is only useful if it's part of a comprehensive program of test, rapid isolation, complete contact tracing, and supportive quarantine. Within that comprehensive strategy, testing can be extremely important. But right. When it's just used as a, you know, test everybody approach with not much follow-up, it does not much good.
Well, contact tracing obviously is so important. Is it too late to implement this effectively since there's been such widespread community prevalence of the virus?
No, I don't think so. I think first off, if I can just share one slide because it
That'd
really addresses that very issue. I think what we need, whoops, are you able to see? No, hang on, that didn't work.
Yeah, that goes, there you go.
Sorry.
It's just there.
Okay, one moment. What we keep hearing is this desire for one thing that's going to make COVID go away. And there's not one thing that's going to make COVID go away. The way I like to think of it now is kind of as a 1-2 punch. The first is preventing spread with interventions that keep people from becoming infected. Masks, distancing, cleaning, disinfection, ventilation, hand washing, all of these drive down the numbers. And what we've seen in the US is we drove down the numbers from 50,000 a day diagnosed to 20,000 a day diagnosed. That's not very good. But then we were supposed to mop it up with what we call the box it in strategy of strategic testing, rapid isolation, complete contact tracing, and supportive quarantine. And if you do those two things, you can really get it down to a very low simmer so that when people start interacting again, you don't have explosive spread. We didn't do that in most of the country. So right. Other than, you know, Vermont and Maine, and much of the Northeast actually, where we've seen lower numbers, we're not seeing that kind of high quality. But if you think about all over the world, Iceland, Germany, Senegal, not to mention Taiwan, Hong Kong, South Korea, Australia, New Zealand, they do this. Mm-hmm. Now it's hard for the same reason masks are now hard, because it's been politicized. And we've talked to people who are disease investigators around the country, and they're getting really abusive and evasive answers from people. That's a reflection. Dan and I worked on Ebola in West Africa, and we knew we were doing good services when people, there was actually a risk that people would falsify their Ebola diagnosis because the services were so good. Then you've got good enough services. We're nowhere near that. I mean, that right now, if someone is diagnosed, they're gonna be concerned that they're gonna lose income, that they're gonna have stigma, that their friends will lose income. And that's a recipe for failure. We need to make it more of a supportive program. Contact investigation really is patient support and helping to prevent the spread of COVID.
Right. Again, leadership is so important here in creating these models that are implemented. Dr. Lucey, I want to just talk for a few minutes about treatment. The president received a cocktail of monoclonal antibodies, remdesivir, and steroids that only a handful of people probably in the world have gotten. Can you discuss with us what treatments are currently available and what is known about their effectiveness?
Thank you, Susan. So briefly, the president, as is well known from the public disclosure by his physician and himself, included really, I'd say, four things. One was oxygen, one was the antiviral drug, remdesivir, which hasn't been shown to decrease mortality, but has been shown to decrease the number of days in the hospital until you recover enough to be able to leave the hospital. So that's important, but it doesn't necessarily decrease mortality. On the other hand, he also received a corticosteroid called dexamethasone, which does decrease mortality. Not to zero by any means, but it does decrease mortality, and that was shown first in a very large study in Europe, in the UK. And then I'd say the fourth specific treatment he received was with an experimental monoclonal antibody, actually two antibodies in one, monoclonal antibodies, made by a U.S. company called Regeneron, which I think is based in New York, and who did studies with Ebola in the Eastern Congo with their triple monoclonal antibody against the Ebola virus, which was which helped early stage patients, not late stage patients, that is, with Ebola. So here, this is very new information about the monoclonal antibody. The Regeneron company put out a press release September 29th. Before the president received his treatment, I believe. And it was only in non-hospitalized patients. There's studies going on in hospitalized patients and in patients who don't even have the infection but have very likely been exposed to it because of close family members or other close associates that are infected.
Right.
So I don't want to be unduly negative. I just want to be factual. And I wrote this on one of my 45 blogs on the Infectious Diseases Society of America Science Speaks website about a week ago last Thursday. But in my view, I'm not so optimistic about the preliminary data from Regeneron in non-hospitalized patients because they divided them into two groups, and we don't know which group the president was in when he got it outside of a clinical study. He got it in a way that less than 10 people have received it. So it's not generally available outside of clinical studies now. But the two groups were people who had the infection, were not hospitalized, but either they had antibodies already of their own against the virus or they did not. And it was mostly in people who did not have antibodies in their own who benefited. And that was less than 50%. It was really so negative, it was about 41%. And in my view, the reading of the data that's provided by Regeneron in the press release September 29th, before they asked the FDA for emergency use authorization, EUA, for this monoclonal antibody, two-in-one monoclonal antibody. In my view, there is not any persuasive information that this monoclonal antibody decreased hospitalization or the risk of requiring hospitalization, either in people who already had made their own antibodies or who had not. And to me, that's extremely important, and I just haven't seen that emphasized really by almost anyone in the media or by some others.
That's such a good point, and I think, you know, NIH is just starting the active study to look at other monoclonal antibodies and remdesivir and to see what their effects will be. You know, the president and his doctors say that he's no longer contagious. And I just, aside from his case, I just wondered if you could speak to what the criteria are for physicians determining that a patient can no longer spread COVID-19, and are there tests to determine that? Do we know how long immunity lasts?
So very briefly, we do not know how long immunity lasts. And that's one issue that came up with this reinfection of the person in Nevada that I mentioned that was just reported, I believe in the Lancet this past week. So we don't know. We don't know what's called correlates of protection. In other words, are there certain antibody titers or types of antibody, presumably neutralizing antibody against the spike protein that binds to the receptor called ACE2 on human cells? We don't know how long immunity lasts, and that's very relevant in terms of vaccines. Most vaccines say you need two doses. One, Johnson & Johnson said you only need one dose, but really we don't know how long immunity lasts, whether it's after infection or it's after vaccination. And some follow-up studies have shown decrease in antibodies after people have been infected over the course of several months, but certainly not in everyone. So it's a crucial issue, but we don't know the answer to it. The other question that you asked very briefly about how long is someone still infectious and do we have tests to determine that? I believe the president had an investigational test performed to try to address that. What we really want to know is the virus that might be detected in your nose or throat, is it still infectious? If you just do the PCR test, then we found, and these are studies originally from South Korea, that you can still have a positive PCR test, but it's just fragments of the virus. They're not whole virus. You're not contagious anymore. Mm-hmm. So in general, the CDC guidelines say that, if your fever's gone and you've been 10 days since your symptoms, then you don't have to be retested. But there's caveats. If you still have some symptoms or you still have fever, or I would, again, emphasize strongly that in the president's case, he was taking the steroid dexamethasone, which reliably and predictably and reproducibly takes away fever, whether it's for poison ivy or it's for this disease or for many other diseases. Right. So the fact that his fever went away, it's due to the dexamethasone until proven otherwise.
Right. I know we're going to go to audience soon, but before we do, I just want to ask a few more questions. Dr. Frieden, would you tell us about the current state of vaccine development? I know there's more than 165 candidates being tested, different mechanisms of action. What are they and how optimistic are you that there will be a vaccine?
I'm guardedly optimistic that there will be a safe and effective vaccine. The reason I say that is that it does appear that people can develop immunity to the virus. There is at least one very interesting epidemiologic study of an outbreak where two people who had a high titer of antibodies didn't get infected and almost everybody else did on a fishing ship, actually. So I would say some people get some level of immunity for some duration of time. That's pretty vague, but that's enough to give us guarded optimism that some vaccines may work somewhat.
Mm-hmm. And what percentage of people would have to be vaccinated before we could go back to normal, a new normal?
Well, I think we have unrealistic expectations of vaccines. A vaccine is not going to bring a fairy tale ending to this pandemic. Suppose we have a good vaccine that's 70% effective. That's more effective than any flu shot. And suppose we get 70% of people to take it. That's much higher than we get for the flu. That's still only half of people protected. So for the foreseeable future, masks are in and handshakes are out.
Okay, well, the economy has taken a huge hit. What's the state of reopenings of communities around the country? How are these decisions being made and how should they be made, including schools? Some experts think that our children's education and healthy development is being jeopardized by remote learning and social distancing. With the surge of infections in many states, is it safe for children to be going back to school?
There's a false dichotomy here. It's not health versus economy. The way to get our economy back is to control the virus. And if you look at the parts of the country that have just said kind of damn the torpedoes, full speed ahead, they're doing worse. both in terms of the viral load and in terms of the economic downturn. So we need to have a smarter, more strategic reopening. And that means you can do things like masks and distancing and ventilation that allow us to do more in society. You also can look at where there is spread. Now, I agree, and we've been saying since March, schools are really important to try to keep open because in-person learning is much better for kids, particularly lower income kids, than distance learning. And interestingly, what we're seeing in K through 12, as well as in universities, is the spread is not in the academic setting. It's in the fraternities and sororities, it's in sports and schools, and it's in choirs. Those are things that can be adapted. We need to move forward adapting what we do to the new reality that COVID is here for a while. And there isn't this friction between the economy and public health. In fact, public health is the route to reopening, particularly of schools, but also of parts of the economy. Now, that's not to deny that there's some really tough issues here. Restaurants, bars, hospitality, major issue. You know, you can't wear a mask while you're eating your dinner. So that's going to be, I think, one of the last areas of the economy to recover fully. Even if they're open, and opening bars is a bad idea when you've got a lot of spread, because we know that a lot of spread occurs in bars. But even when they're open, most people aren't going to go because they don't feel confident going. So the pictures you see on the news of crowded bars are not a reflection of what will happen if you open up.
Right. Well, this brings me to the last question I think I want to ask both of you before we open up to viewers' inquiries. How does the COVID-19 pandemic end? And do you have any predictions when that might happen? And lastly, how can we learn to live with the virus until we conquer it? What's your hope for the future?
Well, I think this virus, the pandemic, is going to end not with a bang, but a whimper. It's going to be something that we gradually manage better through a comprehensive approach that includes all of the tools at our disposal, that will have different areas doing different things based on their level of spread of the virus, that will have a very important use of vaccination, but understanding that that's just one of the things that we have to do, that will do much better with testing, tracing, and isolation, quarantine, and that we will be adapting. I expect to see elevators with voice recognition or hands-free touching. I expect to see doors left open more on internal hallways of schools so that fewer people have to touch them. I expect to see that we've learned that we don't have to have as many meetings and as much travel as we had before. And I hope to see a resumption of global collaboration and global travel as we can do that with increasing safety.
Thank you. Dr. Lucey, your thoughts? How does it end?
I agree with Tom. And I think it won't be linear either. There will be, as the epidemic has been, I like to characterize it as high tide waves and low tide waves, but there's always waves coming in. As far as the epidemic in the United States, that's the way it's been. And I think that how it ends, it's not going to be smooth. It's not going to be linear. It's going to be a process with ups and downs. I hope not too many high tide problems. But I do think that there will be more than one vaccine that receives emergency use authorization by the beginning of 2021, if not before. Some monoclonal antibodies, some additional antiviral drugs, and perhaps a cytokine inhibitor drugs, all of which are being studied now in the United States and around the world. But I think it's going to come back to the basics of the Tom showed in his slide, really, you know, good hand hygiene, social distancing, of mask use. And in the end, it gets back to the issue of trust. And if I can just mention one phrase that occurred to me at 3 a.m. while working in Liberia in October of 2014 with Doctors Without Borders and providing hands-on care or gloves-on care to patients. And the phrase is very short. It's this: it's every drop of water in the ocean is the ocean. That's the frame of mind that we need to have and to create in terms of having trust, so that everything that I do or don't do impacts, for better or for worse, what my neighbors, my family, and everyone else in our country and in other countries.
Thank you. Well, thank you. I think that's very important that we're all interconnected. And that brings me back to Patricia to connect with our audience's questions.
Well, thank you so much for a very important conversation. And we have a lot of questions. We won't be able to get to all of them, but let's start with Julie Barkenbush, please.
Yes, hi, and thank you for taking my question. I am a small business owner in the Southwest United States. Been working from home for 7 months, architectural firm. We can certainly work from home, but I'd like to start to get people back into the workplace. In addition to CDC protocol, are there any other protocol that you would recommend? And would you even recommend returning at this point? Thank you.
Well, first I'd say do follow the CDC protocols. They're good. Despite all of the hits that CDC is taking, there's great information on their website. They've had 1.6 billion clicks, so Americans are voting with their clicks. It would really much depend on the level of disease in your community. If you have explosive spread in your community, it's not a good idea. Now, if you want to go in alone or have one person in the office at a different time, why not? If you can get there safely, that's fine. But in terms of people together, there's lots you have to be careful about. Snack rooms, bathrooms, meeting rooms, people being together, will they mask, protocols for sick leave. So frankly, at my organization, we have the same debate. It's a risk benefit. And ultimately, people may be concerned about how they get there, what they do there. Have there been adaptations at the workplace? And frankly, people are getting pretty used to, for all of the annoyance we have with Zoom, people are getting pretty used to it. So I would say it's a risk benefit, and you kind of look at does the potential benefit outweigh the potential risk?
Okay, thank you. How about Bodenga Boyega? You're next.
Hi, Patricia, and hi, Susan. Thank you so much to the distinguished panel. It's a pleasure to be here. So my question is directly to all the panelists. I currently work as the COVID-19 facility manager in Nigeria, and looking forward to all the distinguished leaders. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you.
Yes. So what can I learn from you in times of pandemic? Because I believe you've been through a lot of epidemics in the past, a lot of pandemics. What can I learn in order to pioneer change in my own community here? Thank you.
Dan, do you want to start and then I'll continue?
Okay, thanks, Tommy. Just briefly, well, first, Bodenga, thank you very much for joining us from Nigeria, where it's much later at night. And certainly Nigeria has much experience with many different epidemics, even a number of them going on now, as well as COVID. So I have great respect for the Nigerian CDC and the newer African CDC that I'm sure Nigeria works with closely. Dr. Chika, for example, as a leader in public health in Nigeria. For me, I'd really just like to emphasize again the bigger picture, if you will, the importance of trust. And that means communication, two-way communication, with people who are affected by the epidemic or who might be affected, who are at risk. But the communication has to come from some person or persons or organization that is trusted by the community that you want to engage in the dialogue and to help them prevent and to respond to the epidemic. So I think in that sense, it's local, it's regional, in terms of effective communication and trust. And as far as looking forward, or really, I would say looking now and looking forward, for me, epidemics after all these years, being involved like Tom has and many others around the world, including in Nigeria, Dr. Tomori, I know very well. It's the question I get a lot is, well, what's next? We have a big exhibit since 2018 to 2022 at the Smithsonian Museum of Natural History about epidemics, especially ones that come from animals, as maybe two-thirds of them do, that affect humans. And the final of the 10 sections, there's a question, what's next? What's now, what's next? And what I like to say is the final thing on the wall is what's next is already here, but we haven't recognized it yet. So I'll come back to the word recognition that I think is the main message that I'd like to offer to you, sir, is the importance of recognition as part of the prevent, detect, respond. You need to have trained teams to recognize when a new outbreak is occurring and then recognize what needs to be done immediately and in a comprehensive and a sustained manner. That's the overarching principle that I would suggest.
Thank you. That's a great thing. I would just add to that that we have to use reality as our drill. Even in between epidemics or emergencies, there are always outbreaks, whether it's foodborne or measles or yellow fever. And Nigeria has made a lot of progress with the Nigeria CDC. Now the challenge is to make that progress on the state-by-state level. There's a lot more ground that can be gained with laboratory networks. But the other thing that to think hard about is data analytics. And how can we analyze data well so that it sings, so that we can convey it well to people who need to make decisions? And related to that, how can we communicate well? You have kind of a master class in how to not communicate well from the US over the past 8 months, but you also have some very good examples at the state level in the US and globally, from New Zealand and Taiwan and several countries in Africa, including Senegal and Uganda, on really good communications. Communication is not ancillary to epidemic response, it's central to it. So, and we can improve our communication skills for all of the health threats that we face. I'll stop there.
Thank you. We've got so many questions, so I apologize to those who won't be able to get to, but we love getting these international questions. Colonel Butera, you're next. We're going to try to keep these quick if we can, so we can get a few more in, please.
Thank you very much, distinguished panel. The world is being ravaged by the COVID-19 virus. The world needs to work comprehensively together to decisively win this invisible enemy. What major steps should we take as a world to shorten the time to win the virus if we really have to change the future against the fight of this virus, the fight we have with this virus? Thank you.
Thank you.
Colonel, thank you for your question. I think that the world needs to work together, as Dr. Tedros, the Director General of the World Health Organization, or OMS, has been saying repeatedly since the winter and beginning of the epidemic and now pandemic. And I think that, my own country, the United States, needs to work more closely. It's just my own opinion. I don't speak for anyone else, but just my own self, I think strongly that we need to work with World Health Organization and more with other countries, including China, not just on vaccines, but on every aspect of the pandemic.
I think all of us on this panel have also had experience working on another major pandemic, AIDS, that was very little was known about. There was so much stigma at the beginning of the epidemic, and so much has been transformed, including the Global Fund to Fight HIV, AIDS, TB, and Malaria, to bring support and funding and to help build public health infrastructure. But I think these kinds of models are there if we have the leadership to implement them with COVID.
Dr. Blumenthal, I think that's a really great point. And as we have global structures, We need WHO. It's absolutely essential, but it's probably a necessary but not sufficient condition for a much better global response and preparedness to epidemics. Mm-hmm. I'm going to have to apologize that I have to leave exactly at 4, which is in 1 minute from now, so I won't be able to go over. I will say I see one of the questions in the chat as, what do we think of the herd immunity proponents? It's a dangerous delusion. The only way to get to herd immunity is with lots and lots of people who die unnecessarily. And this concept that you can protect the vulnerable is simply wrong. Only about 3% of Americans who are over 70 live in nursing homes. And about 40% of adults have some underlying condition. So the vulnerable is all of us, essentially. Just what Dan was saying very eloquently about the ocean. The only way to protect the vulnerable is to protect all of us. So it's a very dangerous delusion. And on that not so positive note, I'm going to have to sign off.
But we can't thank you enough, Dr. Frieden. It was a masterful class here, masterclass on COVID-19. I hope we can kick it. It is 4 o'clock, so I'm so sorry we didn't get to everybody who has a question. Thank you so much, everybody, for joining us today. We've got a lot of incredible events coming up, including one next week with Paul Bagala, Michael Schmidt from the New York Times, Rachel Bike-Kofer, and Cynthia McFadden moderating. So it's going to be very interesting about the race. So please join us next week. Dr. Lucey, Dr. Blumenthal, Susan Blumenthal, we thank you so much. I hope we can have you back. I hope we don't need to have you back anytime too soon, but maybe to wrap up what's happening. Do you have any last words, Susan or Daniel?
Well, I just wanted to say that, remind our audience that throughout history, infectious diseases have killed more people than war, and we must remain vigilant against them. And that, you know, as been underscored today, we need this national plan guided by science that really addresses data, surveillance, testing, treatment, vaccine development, a 21st century plan that mobilizes all sectors of our society. And that means that each one of us must intensify our efforts. We need to work together to fight this war against the coronavirus so that someday soon, COVID-19 is a disease found only in the history books. Thank you again, Patricia and Common Good, and Dr. Frieden and Dr. Lucey for your leadership.
We admire you so much, all of you. Thank you so much.